Everyone, I am so excited to bring an amazing sister in Christ to you. I've been on her show. You probably follow her on social media already, but if you don't, I'm going to highly suggest that you do, and to get her new book, which you can see I've got it already with tabs and dog-eared. I love this book. You're Not Enough, and that's okay. And it's the subtitle, it says it all, Escaping the Toxic Culture of Self-Love. As many of you know, I came out of the New Age, and as a kid, I was raised on positive affirmations and visualization. And then I worked with a woman who's called the Queen of Positive Affirmations, Louise Hay, for over 20 years. And I'm here to back up everything Ali is saying. And just let me read you this little excerpt to see if you relate to this, okay? While all valid feelings are real, not all real feelings are valid. The culture of self-love tells us that our feelings are valid because deep down we're perfect. Therefore, we can and should trust ourselves. But this is both irrational and unbiblical. As we've already established, we're actually fundamentally flawed, which means that our feelings are too. And of course we know Jeremiah 17:9 says the heart is deceitful and sick. And so it's such a relief to have someone tell this truth, Ali. Thank you so much for bringing this to us.
Well, thank you so much for having me. You said that really well, that it is, it's a relief to realize that we're not enough. It's a relief to realize that we don't have to follow our hearts and follow our feelings. As you know, that leads us to a dead end. And that is why I wrote this book.
Well, your show is called Relatable. And I'm sure you hear this all the time. You are relatable. You're like our best friend. And a lot of your shows are from curled up on your sofa. And it is. It feels like that. It feels like you're on the sofa with your best friend. And this book has the same feeling. It just feels like your best friend who tells you the truth, not one of those friends who says, oh, you know, everything's going to be okay. You speak from your heart and from your experience. I love your stories in the book and just your penchant for truth telling with love.
Well, thank you so much. And I've had you on my show, as you already said, and I encourage everyone listening, if you haven't heard Doreen on my show, you need to go listen. That is by far one of the most popular episodes I've ever done. And let me just take a second to encourage you, because I know doing what you do, it has, it can bring a lot of criticism from people who are feeling defensive and who are still lost. But I get emails frequently from people who tell me that they were saved after they listened to my interview with you, that the Lord used that interview to open their eyes to deception. They didn't realize they had been deceived. You never know really when you're being deceived, and that they came to the Lord and they came and then learned what good theology is like. And so I just want to thank you as well for everything that you do and for the truth that you speak. And it really is an honor to now get to be on your show. So thank you.
Thank you, sister. All glory to God, of course. Yes. God's using both of us. And so let's just dive in and talk about your book, because there's so much to unpack here. And what was the reason you wrote this book?
Yes. So as you said, I host the podcast Relatable. We talk about theology, culture, news, politics. The point is to try to look at everything that's going on in the world and fit it into a biblical perspective. So I talk to a lot of people. I talk to people like you. I talk to different politicians. And we also, on our own, we analyze everything that's going on through the truth of God's word. And a couple of years ago, when I started the podcast, a lot of my female listeners were asking me about this idea of self-love, that they had seen professing Christian teachers talk about the importance of loving yourself, and actually that you can't love other people until you love yourself. And so I started to get quite a few questions asking me, okay, is this biblical? It sounds good. It kind of feels good. It feels empowering to think that self-love is the key to my happiness, and self-love is the key to purpose and truth and wisdom and all of these things. But is that really true? And of course, as you and I know, it's not true. But what I found in my research is that A, this idea that self-love is the prerequisite to all of your life's success and fulfillment is not a new idea. It's been around a long time. And especially over the past few decades in psychology, this idea that self-esteem is the only way for you to be a healthy, fulfilled person. But it has seeped into the evangelical church and particularly into women's ministries. And it comes in the form of Jesus says to love your neighbor as yourself, which means that loving yourself is the prerequisite to loving other people. And the definition of loving yourself is not a biblical definition that's typically propagated, but one that is very superficial, that literally just says that you have to look in the mirror and you like what you see. You have to believe that you are some awesome, empowering, successful, ambitious woman, and that all your dreams are going to come true if you just put your mind to it and you put yourself first. Well, what I found is that also, not just that this is an old idea that is everywhere, that is very pervasive, but also that a lot of the women who are propagating this idea and a lot of the women who are buying into this idea are not happy. So they're talking about the importance of happiness. They're talking about the importance of self-love. Not only are they still very openly and publicly dealing with feelings of self-loathing, self-deprecation, a lot of times their relationships are broken and unhealthy. And that satisfaction that they are guaranteeing to other people, if they just read their book, if they follow their self-love program, they actually aren't experiencing themselves. And they chalk it up to, well, it's just a process. Self-love is just a process, and I will eventually get the fulfillment that self-love promises me. Once I realize how awesome I am, once I manifest my awesomeness, then I will finally be happy. But it looked like it was never happening. And I started getting emails from women who said, I used to follow those motivational mantras. I used to follow what I call in the book, toxic mommy culture, that says, you know, your kids are just brats and distractions and you need to put yourself first and do what you want to do. Your husband, it needs to get out of the way of your own ambitions. I got a lot of messages and emails from women saying, I followed this world of self-love that told me that I am the most important thing. I'm the center of my universe, all these lies. And it led me to a dead end. I actually ended up being more depressed, more insecure, more listless, and more purposeless and lonely than I was before. And the point of this book is to point us to the liberating, freeing reality that the reason why we are being brought down to a dead end when we follow the road of self-love is because the self can't be both the problem and the solution. Mm-hmm. If inside ourselves we're finding those very real feelings of self-loathing and self-doubt and anxiety and all of those things, the antidote to those things won't also be found inside ourselves. And if we keep looking inside ourselves in these finite, flawed beings for perfection and for fulfillment, we're going to keep getting frustrated and disappointed and depleted. And so I'm saying, get off the hamster wheel. Get off the hamster wheel. You are not expected, you are not responsible for, and you don't have the capacity to be your own God, to mm-hmm. be your own fulfillment. You are not enough. Jesus Christ is your sufficiency, and it right. is only in taking your eyes off of yourself and onto Christ that you are actually going to find the purpose and fulfillment that you're looking for. Long answer, but that's
amen. No, hey, I want to go hallelujah. Amen. Thank you for speaking the truth. It is so true. I mean, I worked alongside a lot of those motivational speakers for years. We toured the world together, and I don't want to be a gossip, but I do want to affirm what you're saying. There are unhappy people, broken relationships, and on top of that, alcoholism and drug addiction was rampant in that community of the people who profess the positive affirmations and the self-love, self-care. You're right. You can't take the problem and fix it with the problem.
Right. It was Stephen Bancars, whom I know that you know, he said mm-hmm. on my show, something that I thought was really profound along the lines of what we're saying is that the self makes a terrible God because you can't tell yourself anything that you don't already know. Right. That seems so obvious, but it was such a poignant way of saying that very blatant truth mm-hmm. that you can't tell yourself what's true. You can't bring wisdom to yourself because you are limited to what you already know. And so again, this idea that you're enough is so silly, because we already realize we have to go outside of ourselves to glean any wisdom or glean any direction or happiness or whatever it is that is not already inside ourselves. The question isn't whether or not we're enough. We all know that we're not. Whether or not you tell yourself that you are or not, you are constantly depending on other people for the things that you need. The question is, once you realize you're not enough, where are you going to go to get that sufficiency and that purpose that you are looking for? Are you going to look for it along the aisles of the bookstore with all the self-help books? Are you going to go to these self-love gurus? Are you going to go to this toxic culture of self-love to tell you who you are? Because they are all just as lost as you are. And all they're doing is capitalizing upon their lostness. Or are you going to go to the person who knows exactly who you are and tells you that there is a better way? And that better way isn't just that, well, you look to God and he tells you how awesome you are and that's enough. It's that he says, stop thinking about what you think about you. Stop thinking about yourself and take your eyes off of yourself and put it on me. And it is through fixing our gaze on the cross that we are relieved from that pressure of constantly obsessing over ourselves for better and for worse.
It's so true. I love that you are being so outspoken about this truth. The premise in our culture is that we're perfect, whole, and complete, as you said, that ipso facto, then our feelings are a perfect litmus test. But I think if we're honest and we look back on our lives for the times when we made decisions on emotions, on feelings, on our gut, on our dreams, we can see that it never led to anything satisfactory, nothing lasting, and it definitely didn't give us that meaning and truth that everyone craves.
No, and I write about this in my book with my own experience. As I was getting a couple of years ago, these messages and these stories from these women talking about how they got caught in this toxic culture of self-love and what I call in this book, the cult of self-affirmation, telling themselves how awesome they are, realizing they're not, and then just being stuck on this never-ending hamster wheel. Yeah. I realized that without knowing it, that I was chasing after the same things when I was going through this identity shifting season in college. So I would say it's typically when women are going through a season of what feels like an identity shift, like they're either coming into marriage or they're coming into a new job or they're coming into motherhood, and all of a sudden they're uneasy. All of a sudden they're like, hang on, I feel inadequate. I feel insufficient. I feel insecure. I need something to make me feel better. So they look to Instagram and they see these messages, you are enough. They see these messages, you're perfect the way you are. And it feels really good. And it feels like balm for the weary heart. And you keep on going down that road until you realize that it really takes you nowhere. But I didn't realize that I was doing the same thing when I was in college and I was in that identity shifting season. I went through a bad breakup. I had been with this person for a long time, thought that it was going to lead to marriage. And I just didn't realize, I was 21 years old, that I had attached a lot of my identity and a lot of my faith to this person. And when that relationship ended, I was questioning who I was and what I believed. And rather than planting my feet on the solid rock of Christ, I said, well, you know, why don't I do me? Why don't I do what makes me happy? Why don't I kind of forego the painful healing and try to numb myself and distract myself with the things that feel good? And I had plenty of people in my life telling me that that was the right thing to do. And I'm not blaming them, but you will never run out of the people who will tell you just to do what makes you happy. And so that included all the things that a lot of my friends have been doing for 3.5 years, drinking, going out, unhealthy relationships. During all of that time, because I wanted so bad to feel worthy and wanted and enough, I also developed an eating disorder where I either wasn't eating, or if I did eat, it was a binging and purging type scenario. I attached the weight to my level of attractiveness to guys, which is where I got a lot of my value. And I was meeting some of these people by going out and drinking. So it was all a vicious cycle that I told myself at the time that I was going to get out of it. As soon as I was in my last semester of college, as soon as I graduated, I'm not stuck in this. I'm not a slave to sin. I knew all the Christian terminology. This is just fine. It's just a season of my life. I am proving, I thought, to myself that I'm enough, that I don't need a guy, I don't need God, I don't need religion, I don't need parameters, that I am enough for myself and I'm doing what makes me happy and telling myself that I'm perfect the way I am, when I just didn't have the insight at the time to realize that what I was doing was proving not that I loved myself, but actually a lot of self-hatred and a lot of insecurity. And it took, so I did that for about 8 or 9 months of my life. And I, by the grace of God, I just thank God that it wasn't longer than that. I graduated from college and I was still stuck in the same cycle. So I thought, okay, well, it wasn't just college. Maybe I am really trapped in this. And I felt all of a sudden that I couldn't stop. I kept telling myself, okay, I'm not going to go out this weekend, or I'm going to stop drinking, or I'm not going to binge and purge today, but I couldn't stop. I was a slave to sin and I didn't want to admit that to myself. But finally, when I couldn't take it anymore. Like, I had a full-time job. I was supposed to be this mature adult. I knew the truth of the gospel. I knew a way that was better. And I just literally woke up one day and was like, I can't do this anymore. This is not sustainable. This is not who I want to be. And so I decided that I was going to see a Christian counselor. And thankfully, that Christian counselor spoke the truth in love to me and told me, look, if you keep on going down this road, especially with this eating disorder, you will die. Like, binging and purging, bulimia is a deadly eating disorder. And I just hadn't even considered that. So I'm 22 years old at this point thinking, this is not how I want to go out. And this is not what I want to do. So again, by the grace of God, he used someone speaking the truth in love, hard truth that I did not want to hear, to cause me to repent and to come back to him. And I just am so thankful for that. And that, just as a side note, for everyone who ever feels condemned or persecuted for speaking the truth in love, it is only in speaking the truth in love that God is able to use you in that way, right, to bring people to repentance. So it's absolutely worth the hurt feelings, by the way, for someone's eternal soul. So that's what happened to me. That was my dead end in chasing after the God of self and chasing after my own enoughness and sufficiency, my own happiness, my own fulfillment that I told myself that I had in myself. And the reality is that in searching inside myself for all of those things, all I found was decay and lostness and a sad little insecure girl who didn't know who she was. And thank the Lord to God. Thank God for saving me. And that's what I, want people to see in this book, that it's going to lead you to a dead end. And if you can learn from my mistakes, so you don't have to learn from yours.
That's right. Oh, well, praise the Lord for leading you out of that toxic cycle. Yeah, and also for sharing it so that others can recognize that in themselves. You know, the affirmations are like candy. They taste good. They feel good. They give you a boost for a moment, but then there's this crash. And I love how you are talking about how affirmations comfort people in their sins instead of leading them to repentance like your counselor did. So it's like putting a Band-Aid over a serious injury that needs to have care. And that care comes from Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. So this is this book, I pray a lot of people will read and that they will send it to people. I pray that this disrupts this crazy cycle that I see. When I was in the New Age, you didn't see the self-love culture happening. I was literally in the New Age when I saw it born. I can't remember the year time frame, but it started with a lot of self-care talk first. You know, it was like, okay, you've got to take care of yourself. Like you said, you have to put yourself first. They would always make the analogy of the airplane where you put the oxygen mask off on yourself first and then your kid. And I followed that, and it literally destroyed our family because I became very self-centered and narcissistic, and I didn't put my kids first. Like, I totally, totally regret. I became this very independent, ambitious woman. And it's super toxic for families. And like you said so well in your book, it doesn't lead to the happiness that it promises.
No. And I think one reason that it is so deceiving and why people stay in it, and this is something that I heard from a lot of people who are reaching out to me, and something that I think you and I talked about in our conversation, is that a lot of these positive affirmations and a lot of these tactics that are in books like Girl, Wash Your Face, they will work for a period of time. You will feel more confident, and it might give you the confidence that you need to fight for that promotion or to lose the weight or to save the money and buy the car. It might accomplish the things in the short term that they say that they are meant to accomplish. My encouragement is to not be deceived by what seems like short-term success at the expense of your theology and therefore possibly at the expense of your soul. I mean, you know, the verse that says there's no use in gaining the whole world and losing your soul. And unfortunately, that's what you see in a lot of this pseudo Christian self-love theology that we see perpetuated by a lot of these pseudo Christian teachers on Instagram, is that it sounds good to say that you have to do all of these things in order to love yourself and manifest the love that you have for yourself. And then you see some kind of tangible result in your life that makes you feel good, or you feel at ease one day. But like you said, it doesn't last, and it doesn't lead to the lasting fulfillment that you're looking for. Isn't that what you want? Like, isn't that what we're really all after, is lasting fulfillment? And that's exactly what Jesus offers. He says, I am the living water. I am the bread of life. You come to me, you never thirst again. Isn't that what we all want? Absolutely. To never thirst again? In the world of self-love, it will quench your thirst, but it's like drinking a Diet Coke in a desert. Like, it's going to quench your thirst a little bit and it's going to taste good, but you are going to be parched over and over again. And my encouragement to the women listening to this, you don't have to do that. You don't have to do that. You are free from that now. And Jesus offers you the living water and the bread of life that you are trying and failing to find inside yourself.
Amen. And it, you know, reminds us, of course, of the woman at the well, who was the picture of a broken woman, and who Jesus did say, you'll never thirst again if you drink from me. So I think we can all identify with her in some way. I certainly can. And she became one of the first Gentile evangelists for Jesus. Yeah. And so it's okay to admit our brokenness. We can, we don't have to pretend we're perfect or that we can do it all. That's a myth that I tried to live, and it doesn't work, that we can't have it all. We need priorities, and our priorities must be biblical. Allie, I wonder if you could break down something you said earlier about the Lord's royal law to love your neighbor as yourself, which of course we follow that commandment because we love Jesus. But the end part of that verse is where people get fixated, right? Yes. To love your neighbor as yourself. It's almost like that's a parenthesis.
Yes. So there are professing Christian teachers who have written about this and who have spoken about this, and they say that love your neighbor as yourself means that you can't love other people until you love yourself. And they may not realize, but in doing that, they're actually belittling the kind of love that Jesus is talking about. And they are making it to mean some kind of affection. And so you have to have affection for yourself. You have to have self-esteem. You have to like what you see when you look in the mirror in order to love other people well. Well, that's not at all what Jesus is talking about. He's talking about a much more powerful love, a much more grounded love that is not based on self-esteem, that's not based on feelings or circumstances or affection at all, but based on a persistent interest for the good of other people. So when he says as yourself, he is talking about the love for ourselves that we are all born with. As Ephesians 5 says, no man ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it. We all love ourselves in the sense that we are all looking out for our own best interest. I think it was Blaise Pascal who said that without exception, every man is looking to pursue his own happiness. Now, that does not mean that there aren't people who struggle with self-loathing. And even I get questions, okay, if everyone really loves themselves, then how do you explain people who struggle with thoughts of suicide? But as I've heard John Piper say, even those people are looking to alleviate their pain. They're even looking to alleviate those bad circumstances. It is in pursuit of their self-interest that, unfortunately and tragically, they are struggling with those thoughts and sometimes carry them out. So every person is looking out for their own interest. They're looking out to quench their thirst, to satisfy their hunger, to make sure they are safe, to make sure they are cared for, to make sure their needs are met. So Jesus is saying that natural, inborn, looking for your own interest that you have, apply that to other people. the same way that you so naturally and persistently look to meet your own needs, to meet your own interests, to quench your own thirst, to satisfy your own hunger, do the same thing for other people. It doesn't matter whether you have affection for your neighbor or not. Doesn't matter if they're your best friend. In the same way that it doesn't matter whether or not you like what you look like in the mirror that day or have high self-esteem, you're still going to make sure that all of your needs are met that day. In the same way, make sure that your need or that your neighbor's needs are met. And again, this is such good news. That means that you don't have to wait around to love and serve other people, that you don't have to wait until you have a certain amount of self-esteem or you've come to terms with like the texture of your hair or whatever silly superficial thing it is in order to go out and to love and serve other people. The Bible tells us that it is the love of Christ that compels us to do good and to love other people. And if we are Christians, we have that love of Christ in us always. It is His Holy Spirit that empowers us to do those things, not our affection towards other people. And again, that is such good news that we don't have to depend on our own feelings about ourselves to first love other people. And how many people who are hungry, who are thirsty, who are lonely, who need our help would be missing out if we were all waiting around until we had the proper amount of self-confidence to go out and love and serve them. Thank the Lord. We don't have to wait around for that, but we are liberated, empowered, and enabled right now by the love of Christ, by His power to go out and love other people, no matter how we feel about ourselves today.
Amen. The book is You're Not Enough, and That's Okay by Allie Beth Stuckey. All the links are below. Definitely follow her on Instagram, you guys, because she does a lot of live Instagrams that are always relatable. It's the name of her podcast. And also she goes into the daily news and gives perspective from a biblical worldview that is very edifying. I really appreciate your political broadcasts, and I've seen you on Hannity and such. And I think you also were giving some pro-life speeches. Did I see it was like at the UN or something? I mean, you're all over the place.
It was, yes, I testified before Congress last November 2019. I had 4 pro-abortion witnesses, and then I was the pro-life witness to just talk about the importance of defending life. And you want to talk about people who are unfortunately stuck in darkness and who are just so, so deceived by Satan. Mm-hmm. Talk to someone in the abortion industry or who is propping up the abortion industry. And that's an industry that we need to just be praying for, that God would continue to soften hearts and to open eyes to see the evil that is being perpetrated there. So anyway, thank you though for that encouragement. I really appreciate that.
Well, it helps that we have the same worldview. So every time I hear you talk, I'm like, yeah, you go, girl.
Well, thank you.
So anyway.
And you as well. And thank you for, I know I already said this, but seriously, thank you for everything that you do and for being vulnerable and sharing your testimony. Like I said, I personally know several people who just from our conversation, the Lord has used that conversation to save them. And just praise God for using imperfect vessels to bring people to Himself.
Yeah. And thank you, Jesus, for giving Allie and myself boldness to speak out publicly in this age of cancel culture that doesn't want to hear it.
So, right.
I'll be praying for you and your protection and your continued ministry work. It's just amazing. So thank you so much for your time, sister.
Yes. Thank you so much for having me.